That button, you're muted.
Whoops, I'm sorry. That was just a test. Hi, everyone. I'm State Representative Danielle Friel Otten. Thank you so much to everyone for tuning in to the second discussion on our series on youth mental health and the pandemic. And thank you to our speakers who've agreed to be a part of our panel tonight. Even before the pandemic, youth mental health has been an important legislative priority for my colleague, Representative Sappey, and me. And this past year has introduced a whole new set of concerns for children, parents, and families. Last month, we focused on very young children in pre-K through second grade age groups. And this month, we're talking about the challenges facing children in grades 3 through 7. I want everyone to know that you are not going through this journey alone. We are here to share information and resources that can help. And with that, I'd like to turn it over to my friend and colleague Representative Sappey.
Thank you, Danielle. Hi, I'm State Rep. Christina Sappey from the 158th in Chester County, which is sort of central and southern Chester County. And I'm so appreciative of this opportunity to have these conversations with my colleague, Danielle. Danielle and I sort of connected on our interest in this policy area early in our first term. Danielle is the parent of young children. I'm the parent of young adults. And I think, there's a synergy there. There's definitely, I learned so much from her. Obviously, my kids are older now, so things have changed. You know, what it's like to raise young children has changed. And I'm experiencing right now what young adults are going through. And I've seen over the years how mental health has become such a huge component of raising children and raising, you know, solid, grounded citizens. And it always should have been, but we're now finally having these conversations about this as a part of, you know, overall health. So I'm very interested in what we're going to learn tonight, because I do recall, and this may have changed. So again, I'm interested in what our panelists will say, but I remember third grade being such a pivotal year for my children. And this is the first year you're expected to start learning from the things that you've, you know, the tools that you've been given, you know, through pre-K to this point. Now the learning, you know, using all of those tools begins. So what does learning look like with mental health issues, you know, before the pandemic and during the pandemic, and what does reentry look like? So as Danielle says, our families, you know, should take a small bit of comfort in the fact that they're not going through this alone. Our entire community is dealing with this at the same time. So I'm very much grateful again to be here and interested in what we will learn tonight. Thank you.
Thank you, Chris.
Thanks, Daniel.
We're so grateful to be joined by a group of panelists who, through their work, are helping our kids and families through this pandemic every day. We'd like to give each panelist a chance to introduce themselves and give a quick overview of their connection to this work. And then we want to give them as much time as possible to answer your questions. And just as a reminder, you can submit your questions for our panelists to Rep. Otten at pahouse.net. That's Rep. R-E-P. Otten, O-T-T-E-N, at pahouse.net, and we will be able to ask those questions on your behalf to our panelists. So without further ado, I'd like to introduce our panel, and then I will turn it over. So first up, we have Dr. Jason Lewis. He's a psychologist and section director of mood, anxiety, and trauma disorders at the Department of Child and Adolescent Psychiatry and Behavioral Sciences at Children's Hospital of Philadelphia. We also have with us Dr. Jennifer Maltone, a psychologist in the Department of Child and Adolescent Psychology and Behavioral Sciences at Children's Hospital of Philadelphia. She's also a faculty member of the Policy Lab at CHOP. And additionally, we have Sue Lombardi. Sue was with us on our last session. She's a supervisor of clinical treatment programs and school-based mental health for the Chester County Intermediate Unit. And we have Christy Jimbowski. She's a prevention programs coordinator for the Downingtown Communities That Care Coalition. And without further ado, I'd like to turn it over to Dr. Jason Lewis to give us a quick intro.
Great. Thank you so much. Really happy to be here tonight. So I appreciate the opportunity to be a part of this panel and, hopefully provide some great information for people. as it relates to mental health and COVID. So yes, my name is Dr. Jason Lewis. I'm a licensed clinical psychologist at Children's Hospital of Philadelphia and the director of the mood, anxiety, and trauma section there. So essentially I oversee clinical work for kids with depression, anxiety, concerns around trauma, and more specifically, my own clinical work is predominantly with kids and adolescents with depression. And so that's most of the work that I do. I also do a lot of work related to suicide prevention, and that's an area of research interest of mine, looking at ways that we can improve our efforts at screening and assessing and treating children at risk for suicide. And that's in not only in behavioral health settings, but also in medical settings at large. So thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Lewis. And we'll turn it over to Dr. Maltone.
Hi, everyone. Thank you for the warm welcome. I'm Dr. Jennifer Maltone, and as you heard, I'm a psychologist at Children's Hospital of Philadelphia. I'm also Associate Director of Primary Care Behavioral Health Research for our department. So I wear a number of different hats, like many of us do here at CHOP. I'm really involved in program development and evaluation with a specific focus on trying to improve access to high quality care for youth with behavioral health conditions. So although we'll be talking a lot about what's been happening since the onset of the pandemic about a year ago, we all are very well aware of the fact that behavioral health access has been a challenge always for youth who have behavioral health conditions. And so one of the ways that I try to address those issues is through my work as a psychologist in our behavioral health program known as Healthy Minds, Healthy Kids, which is an integrated behavioral health and primary care program at CHOP, where we have licensed behavioral health clinicians working as members of our primary care pediatrics teams, so that for families who present to their pediatrician with behavioral health concerns, we can be involved in the care right there on the ground in primary care. I also do a lot of work related to school mental health programming, specifically right now have some funding focused on youth who are in thirds through fifth grade, to address challenges related to executive functioning, which is organization, time management, and planning to get their academic tasks done, very much related to the comment that Representative Sappey made earlier about the transition in third grade when youth get really added burden of trying to move from learning to read to reading to learn, and all of those pieces that can come with added stress related to academics. So those are kind of some of my primary interest areas. Clinically, I also have a specialty focus in youth with attention deficit hyperactivity disorder and other externalizing or disruptive behavior problems. So again, thank you for having me.
Thank you, Dr. Maltone. And Sue Lombardi, would you like to give a quick intro?
Sure. Thank you again for having me back. I'm Sue Lombardi, and I have the pleasure of supervising our clinical treatment programs and school-based mental health for the Chester County Intermediate Unit. I've been with the Intermediate Unit for 21 years now, and I've had the pleasure of watching services, mental health services, grow from me being one of two licensed social workers 21 years ago to now supervising a crew of 70. So I think that speaks, you know, mountains for what we've done over the last 20 years, and most specifically, probably the last 8 or 9. Our services range from partial mental health hospitalization programs and partial drug and alcohol and IOP programs to supportive counseling in school districts. So we have a wide range of levels of care that we support kids in, and throughout all 12 school districts we support.
Excellent. Thank you, Sue. And Chrissy Jambowski from Communities That Care, a repeat guest of ours, if you'd like to give yourself an intro as well.
Sure. Hi, my name is Chrissy Jambowski, and I'm the Prevention Program Coordinator with Communities That Care of Greater Downingtown, or CTC. And really, during this pandemic, we have tried to amplify all of our virtual resources. So thank you so much for having us here to share in this. Our mission is to address specifically prevention and education surrounding drug and alcohol use and mental health for youth, parents, families, community members. And really during this time, we have been, you know, trying to bulk up what we're able to offer to parents to give them kind of tangible, real, use right away type of skills, tips, tricks, those types of things. So during the school year, we actually partnered with Downtown Area School District to offer a parent speaker series and relating actually to mental health specifically. Last week, we had Dr. Matt Bellis on talking about how to reduce stress and giving coping skills. And then in January, we had Dr. Matt Winterstein from Thomas Jefferson University talk about recognizing signs of depression and suicide in adolescence. So all those are available on our website. And I think that'll be linked up with the recording too to access later on. So follow us. Of course, I can't be on the internet without saying follow us on our socials, but we really are trying to offer a lot of resources there. So links to different really best practice sound resources and little tips and prompts and things to do, things that parents could do with their kids to help kind of reduce their stress and anxiety as well as their kids. So I'm excited as a participant to hear everything that we're going to talk about tonight and also hopefully to share some resources and tips too. So thanks for having us.
Excellent, Chrissy. Thank you so much. And thank you to everyone for being here this evening. And are we turning it to Tyler now to moderate question and answer?
We are. Okay. So this is my chief of staff, everyone, Tyler Arkaton, who will be helping us field questions from our viewing public. He will take it from here. Thanks, Tyler.
Thank you, Rep. Yes, and thank you, panelists, for joining us. First, I just want to remind everybody that's listening in, you can still submit questions to RepSappey@PAHouse.net or RepOtten@PAHouse.net. So feel free to submit your live questions there. To start things off, I'm actually going to circle back to the question Rep Sappey raised at the very beginning, and Rep Sappey, please feel free to add to this. But what mental health concerns did we see prior to the pandemic with this age group, and how has the pandemic compounded those concerns?
Jump in, everyone.
Yeah, I'd be happy to jump in and chat a little bit about what we were seeing and what we've been seeing in our primary care network in particular. I think in terms of types of referrals, we've not seen a tremendous shift. The shift has been more in quantity on our end, and in many cases also acuity. So we often were already getting referrals related to disrupted sleep due to, you know, school-related worries and anxiety, mood issues, challenges with disruptive behavior and the parenting challenges that come along with that. These were sort of the very typical types of referrals we would get in our primary care office visits, including youth who were having thoughts of suicide or having concerns about, you know, their own safety. It's the frequency with which these concerns are coming up now has really increased. And so we're hearing very often from our primary care colleagues that it was the proportion of office visits that involve a behavioral health concern is much higher now than they recall being kind of prior to the onset of the pandemic. The other thing that we're noticing is also, as I mentioned, the acuity of the concerns often has been higher. So we have more youth who are presenting to the office in crisis where parents or one of the primary care clinicians has concern about more immediate safety risk because of concerns related to suicidal ideation or behavior, for example.
Yeah, I would agree with Dr. Montone that, you know, the types have not really changed, the frequency. And I would add that that's really been in the last, you know, 3 months, maybe a little bit more. I mean, it was interesting. What we saw last spring was actually like a lot of excitement from kids, like, hey, I don't have to go to school for a little while. And we know from like just years of we know that oftentimes when school is out, whether it be for summer break, problems go away. There's less stress for families. So initially, I think we were seeing, a lot of families being okay with how everything was going. But as the pandemic, as you know, as the calendar has turned and we're now a year in, virtual school has been going on for so long, and that's such a struggle for so many families and kids. Recently there's been a pretty significant increase in concerns raised by parents related to sadness, depression, anxiety, behavioral problems at home. We're also starting to see concerns about return to school, whether that be returning to school now with a hybrid or in anticipation of school next year. So particularly for kids who already were sort of anxious about school, and now they've gotten comfortable not being in school and they're anticipating having to return to school. So there's been a pretty significant increase that we've noticed in our outpatient behavioral clinic at CHOP in the past couple of months.
So to follow up on that, some of our parents have asked, what types of signs should they be looking for to show additional stress or signs of depression or even, suicidal thoughts even? What do those actually manifest in day-to-day life with the student?
Yeah, that's a great question. So I think parents often struggle with is this something that I need to bring to the attention of a mental health professional, or is this something that's normal? So I think that's a question that even pre-pandemic was a hard one for parents. What we sort of tell families is there's a few things to think about. One is really looking at functioning. When symptoms start to impair functioning, that's a pretty significant sign that getting help is needed. Everyone struggles with sadness, from time to time. Everyone gets anxious, so all these, that's a normal part of just being human. And then certainly with kids, that's just being a part of, that's just being a child. But when those symptoms are getting in the way of their academic functioning or their social functioning, that's certainly something to be concerned about. And then we also talk with families about sort of like duration of symptoms. So if a kid is sad for a couple of days or has sleep difficulties for a couple of days, that's typical. But when that's extending to, 2 weeks, the majority of the day, sleeping difficulties, several weeks, those are signs, obviously, that I think it's important to bring to the attention of a mental health professional. And then, Tyler, you mentioned the last thing, anytime there's any concerns related to suicide, self-harm, those are definite indicators of getting a mental health professional involved.
And Rep Otten, do you have a follow-up?
Yeah, I just wanted to ask a question that I think is often on a lot of parents' minds when we're talking about reaching out to a professional. I know in our experience, my son, when he was very young, had some real struggles with some of his medical conditions that we were dealing with as he transitioned into school. And like you said, it started to affect his social functioning. He didn't want to leave our side. He didn't want to go anywhere except for just school, because he knew the teachers there, and he otherwise only wanted to be with us. And it was really affecting his social abilities. And I remember being really nervous when we reached out to the psychologist actually at CHOP, and we had such a wonderful experience there, and they were so helpful. He was four, he's seven now, so this is more than 3 years ago. And to this day, I still utilize some of the strategies that the psychologist helped us with. And so could you give us a sense of when you do reach out, what is that experience like for families? I just always try to ease people's concerns about feeling judged or nervous that they're going to in some way be checked up on, or whether they're doing the right thing as a parent. It's always the right thing to get your kid help if they need it. And so can you share a little bit about what that experience might look like for a family?
Dr. Lewis, would you like to go first and I can jump in, or you want to?
Go ahead.
Okay, so that actually gets at that the crux of part of the reason why we are integrating into primary care, because of the very common concerns and the stigma associated with seeking behavioral health care. So I appreciate you asking the question and giving us the opportunity to sort of demystify the process a bit for the audience. You know, we are here to be part of the team for your children and for your family. And the goal is really to think about a strengths-based approach to how we can teach effective skills and strategies to address whatever the presenting concern may be. So for a young child, like a four-year-old, you're going to see us doing a lot of work directly with parents. And I know we're talking a little bit more today about older children and adolescents. We're going to see more involvement of those kids and adolescents in the care, but we still really rely very heavily on parent involvement in the sessions, because we're going to be teaching strategies that then we need the patients to learn how to use as they're going about their day and encountering things that cause stress and anxiety or the triggers that cause sadness. And so it's this partnership that is so critically important as we think about how we want to encourage implementation of and use of strategies as you take, you know, as you go back about your business with your family at home. So we may teach something to your child and then ask for you to help reinforce the use of that skill in this situation that may be really anxiety producing, for example. So those are some of the types of approaches we would take, but it really is a partnership-based approach where we want to understand from you what your concerns are and then what we can all do together to help improve functioning overall.
And Rep. Sappey, did you have a follow-up to that?
I did. And Danielle, that was such a great question, and it's so perfect. We are definitely aligned mentally. My question is about, you know, well, we've all heard the old saying, denial is a river in Egypt. And how can loving friends and family members compassionately help a parent that may be struggling with sort of taking that first step to ask for help? Because I think a lot of us at this point in time, especially during the pandemic, are working so hard to get our work done, making sure our kids are getting their work done and, you know, keeping all of the plates in the air. You know, it may be really hard to say to yourself, it's time to bring in the cavalry. I need support. I need help. I'm at my wit's end. And you just keep your head down and you keep functioning the way you have been. At what point can, again, a loving family member or someone say, I think it's time to ask for help? Because that's hard. That's hard to hear.
So yeah. I'll jump in and maybe offer a different perspective, since ours is more of an educational setting. So the first thing that I always encourage is the school counselors should be one of your first calls. If it's not to your pediatrician, it should be to your school counselor, right? Because they're in the position where the students are in school more than they are anywhere else. Now, the pandemic certainly has thrown us a little curveball in that adventure. The school counselor has the ability to gently check in and provide support and start to determine what kinds of additional support could be helpful.
Sue, if I'm a grandmother, though, and I'm witnessing my child and, you know, my adult child and my grandchild really struggling, how do I, as the grandparent, talk to my child about my grandchild, or for instance, or if I'm a next door neighbor who's in the pod, how
sure.
do I, because I don't
absolutely.
Think the grandparent
there's a different
call the intermediate unit or the school. I don't think they can.
No.
Yeah.
Well, they could. You could always call anybody and say, hey, I'm concerned. But what I would do is I would talk with them about their functioning in school. Because typically when students are struggling with some mental health concerns, they're having some difficulty functioning in school too. So it's sometimes a gentle push to say, hey, why don't we see if we can get some support in school? As opposed to making it seem like a medical issue. Does that make sense a little bit?
It kind of does. I'm not sure I'm getting my, I guess what I'm looking for is the parent is not acknowledging the need for help. They're overwhelmed. They are not going to take that first step. How can someone from outside, a loving neighbor, a loving friend, or a family member come in and support that parent who probably needs to reach out for help? How do you say that lovingly to somebody? Like, I think your kid needs help and there's help out there and, you know, let me help you. How do we do that?
I think it all comes down to normalizing mental health and mental health treatment. You know, it's a great question. And if you put it into the medical field, people would generally not have a problem having that conversation if it was related to asthma or any other medical problem. And so I think it all comes down to normalizing it. And, you know, I agree with what Dr. Martone and what Sue were saying. Like, one way that we normalize it is by, you know, school-based mental health treatment, by getting behavioral health providers in primary care. But the other way we normalize it is by talking about it more and talking about our own experiences with mental health treatment, or the experiences that we know our neighbor had. So getting back to your original question, I think the grandparents should try to talk about maybe struggles that they've had, maybe struggles that they know that their friend had with their grandchild or their child, you know, that friend's child, and really try to normalize it and say, it's okay. We're all struggling right now. This pandemic is really challenging. And we just need to figure out how we can help, our son, your son, our grandchild, get the help that he or she needs. Because I've heard you talk about how hard it is to get them to do their homework or to do this or to do that. And I heard from so-and-so that there's help for that. So let's try to check it out. I think it all comes back to normalizing it. There's been this stigma and it's unfortunate, but we have to figure out a way to sort of break through that.
Right. Thank you all.
And we actually have a great follow-up question to that. When a parent is feeling that stress and anxiety themselves, how much should they be sharing that with their child, you know, in this age group? Should they be open and honest with them, or should they try and not share that?
I feel like we're all having the same thoughts to share the same similar things. From our standpoint, as far as, you know, parenting and kind of thinking about that role modeling piece of it too, right? So thinking about just, and sharing kind of, it's similar to what Dr. Lewis was saying, I would recommend, and I do this myself, you know, I have a 4-year-old and an 8-year-old, and just try to role model healthy coping strategies as much as you can, whether that be like sharing, oh man, I missed this meeting. I was late. I can't believe this happened. I'm like, it just made me really stressed out. I think I just need to like sit here and just be quiet for a second and take some deep breaths. Do you want to come and sit with me and take some deep breaths? And just kind of, or I just need to listen to this song or this playlist or something, or just using these different coping skills and role modeling. Cause again, it kind of always goes back to your kids are going to, they're going to do what you do more than they're going to listen to what you say. Right. So, and a lot, and kind of similar to the last question, you know, a lot of it has to do with, you know, it's okay to role model, like getting help for yourself and asking for help too. Because I think sometimes when you're in it, you don't realize, hey, I have all these resources around me. I bet that my mom or my neighbor or my other person would be more than happy to, you know, help in one way or another. So I think role modeling though too is a big piece of this, in a way to not even necessarily have to have a big talk, but just kind of role model that you're stressed too. We've been doing this for a year. We're all kind of in this same mode, and how we can access different resources and strategies in healthy ways.
Yeah, I agree. I mean, kids notice a lot more than we give them credit for. And so if they see their mom or their dad or their grandparent struggling, they're going to notice that. And if mom and dad is not talking about it, then, you know, the kid's going to worry even more so, because there's this sort of unspoken thing that's going on with mom or dad. So I agree that there should be some open communication. Obviously, you know, appropriate to the child's age, but, you know, talking about the struggle and and how I'm and what I'm doing to sort of overcome that struggle. And then that's, you know, that's the other piece. You know, it goes back to the oxygen mask in the airplane. You know, you put it on yourself first before the kid. So parents really need to recognize when they themselves need help, because you can't take care of your child if you're not in, you know, in the best state that you can possibly be. So parents need to recognize when they need help as well and kind of seek that out, so that they can best take care of their children.
The other piece I just want to add to both of those really important comments, which I absolutely agree with, is that we're talking about kids between third grade and seventh grade, right? These are kids who know how to access information and can get to a lot of misinformation all over the internet and other places. So if you are thinking that your kids have questions that you're not sure how to answer and don't think about how to answer, they'll find the information somewhere else, and it might not be the information or delivered in a format that you would prefer as parents. So I think that for me is one of the things I share a lot and talk with parents a lot about, to think about how to have a conversation that will be developmentally appropriate, aligned with your family values, and accurate. And so all those things are really important, particularly in the context of the last year and the way information has been shared.
So to that point of this age group seeking information, one question we have is it likely at all for children in this age group to seek help themselves? And if they do, maybe Sue or Chrissy, you might be able to speak to what resources are available to them at schools for that.
You wanna go, Sue, first? You wanna go? Go ahead. Oh, I don't know if she's frozen or I don't know. I was going to say, so school-based settings. So again, it kind of goes back to those school. I mean, well, I guess it depends if the child is what setting they're in, right? Virtual, in-person, hybrid, all the things, right? Schools have student assistance program, the SAP program happening at their in districts. And so, you know, the counselor again is that first point of contact. And I know many schools are doing social emotional learning, different type. I don't know, you know, it varies by district, obviously. And I think Sue, you may be able to speak to this more than I. But school counselors and teacher, most teachers, and that is one of the things that's been taken away as kids have been online, is you're not getting that full picture to necessarily be that stopping point to screen for things. However, if there's a noticeable difference, most likely your teacher's going to see it and reach out, and it can't hurt for a parent to maybe check in. As far as, I guess, is the question of how do kids themselves access resources? Teacher, counselor, Sue, I don't know if you want to touch on
that. Sure. Yeah, I would agree with everything that you just said, too. And something that I know that, especially during the virtual world, in the different formats that the schools have used, like Schoology or whatever their not a techie, whatever their format that the kids jump onto, there's always the school counselors that are posting for this kind of help, go here, for this kind of help, go here. And I'm going to tell you a very unpopular probably suggestion is these kids go to TikTok. So you hate to say it, but kids get a lot of their information from their social media. They're on TikTok, they're on Snapchat, and they're going to go there first probably for their friends. But they do have the access to the schools. There's all kinds of crisis support lines that are up and going. They're probably better at finding it than we are. But it's posted and it's accessible. For our parents, we talked about this the last session too. We have great resources in Chester County. So in terms of parents accessing information, the Chester County, the government, the county link for MHIDD has a whole slew of services that parents can access pretty easily. And it's pretty well defined, like you can search a certain topic or a certain area and it can get you there.
And Chrissy, also wanted to do a shout out for the programs that Communities That Care are working on, because we just actually got an additional grant for you guys to expand the program. And my neighbor happens to be the person who heads them up at Downingtown. But the peer-to-peer support programs that have been built are also a resource for this age group, correct?
Yeah. As Sue was talking, I was like, you know, there really is what our hype clubs are. So Downingtown, so we, with Downtown Area School District, CTC supports what we call healthy youth positive energy. And so they're peer-led prevention groups in grades 6 to 12 in the different buildings. And they're also doing, as soon as you said TikTok and social media, they actually are doing different initiatives and feel-good initiatives and things that have to do with drug and alcohol prevention, education, mental health, a lot of nice posts of like healthy ways to have fun and stay sane at home and beat stress and those types of things. And they're promoting them on social media. And so it is like that peer-to-peer piece. So that's starting within this age group of the 3 to 7. Yeah. So sixth grade is when we have our hype club starting at. So yeah. Thank you for the reminder that I did not share.
All right. And so the next question we have is, there's been a lot of differing opinions about how we handle things during the pandemic and moving forward, right? So how do you explain that debate to this age group as a parent when there are differing opinions and they see their friends handling things differently?
I'll go if you want. I feel this question very deeply as a parent who has had this struggle and conversation. I feel like if you've met one family that's living through the coronavirus, you've met one family that's living through the coronavirus, right? No one has the same setup. No one has the same work situation. No family has the same who they are exposed to, health risks, medical risk, all of those things. I've had the conversations, you know, well, mommy, those people are doing that thing over there and they're not wearing masks. Like, why do they get to do that? And we don't get to do that me personally, I guess our doctors will say if this is right or wrong, but me personally, you know, I just kind of say, you know, well, everybody has to make different choices. You know, this is kind of, and focus on not necessarily what it is we're not doing, but focus on the things that we are doing. So say, you know, well, we can go and have a, you know, outside meetup with our friends and we'll stay outside and all wear masks and set those guidelines and expectations up and kind of just shift it maybe to focus on the things that we are able to do in safe ways that are within the guidelines of what our family has chosen to do. Cause I think, and maybe that's the way to handle it is that, you know, every family is different because everyone has, we don't really know who's being exposed to who's high risk. It's such an individual situation. And I think it's as best as you can try to explain that, you know, we don't really know who's being exposed to who has to go to work, who has to go. It's a different for every single family.
Yeah, Chrissy, I absolutely hear that. I mean, I think, you know, at the end of the day, this is an extremely amplified version of many parenting conversations you've had to have, right? Why can't I play video games for 6 hours after school? Why can't I, you know, be on my social media all night long until 3 in the morning? It's just, this is like the thing that is impacting all of us and in such a public way. But these are similar strategies for these same types of conversations that you've had to navigate with your kids for any type of thing they're asking for and noticing differences between your family and others. But again, in like a really public and stressful way. So I think that it's amplifying the stress that comes with the conversation. But I just recommend relying on your strategies that you've used in the past to highlight your family values and like why you would make those same type of parenting decisions in other circumstances.
I think the only other thing I wanted to add on to that too, you just made me think of this, is making sure that you validate that it's really disappointing. Wow, it's really disappointing that you saw on Instagram or TikTok or something that your friends are getting together and we just can't do that right now. Like just having that valid, I mean, at the end of the day, I think that's what everyone wants, right? Is empathy and validation. So just validating like, wow, I know that's really disappointing. That's really hard. Well, what's something that we can do and come up with an idea of other things you can do? Cause that thing of like, you don't understand how hard it is. Like, so just trying to provide that validation and acknowledging those feelings of, you know, kind of loss and disappointment and those things too, I think is helpful.
And that ties directly into the next question, which is relates to socialization. And is it okay if children are not going to be having that type of socialization, is it okay for additional screen time for their social moments, whether that is an online music class or Zoom calls with friends? Is additional screen time okay for them?
Yeah, I can jump in here. I've had a lot of conversations with families about screen time, electronic usage during COVID. And so, I mean, the short answer is absolutely, Tyler. You know, one of the things that this, you know, if there can be a silver lining to a pandemic, it has shown us all of the other ways that we can use electronics and screen time. We can use it for staying in touch with our family that lives across, you know, on the other side of the country. We can use it for socialization. We can use it to enhance our hobbies and our interests and things. Socialization with peers is an incredibly important part of their life. And if they are not able to do it because of COVID restrictions, then we have to look for other ways to be able to do that. And so doing it over social media or Zoom or anything like that is incredibly important and necessary. And then, you know, when families are struggling with this issue of amount of screen time, I mean, the first thing that I say to families is, you know, give yourself a break. We're in the middle of a pandemic, which is really, really stressful. And so if your kid spends an extra hour or two on screens, that's okay. You know, we'll get through this. So I think first thing that I tell parents is, it's okay. You know, you can allow that. We use electronics as a coping mechanism, as just a way to feel better. And so during really stressful times, that's okay. And so if you go into it with this idea of how am I going to get back to my pre-COVID structure of electronics, it's probably not going to happen. You know, recognize that first off, that you're not going to get to, you know, before there was no screens during the school week. Well, that's not going to happen now. But let's think about how we can sort of find a middle ground, and let's see how we can diversify screen use. And you know, maybe it's not spending it all playing a video game, but it's a little bit of a video game, but then also maybe a Zoom call with a friend, maybe then also watching some YouTube about, you know, an art project that I like to do, and kind of trying to diversify the screen time and fill the buckets that we used to fill in other ways. Now maybe it needs to be filled with screen time, but that's okay.
Dr. Lewis, you touched on something I think for me as a parent, at least, it has been a real learning curve during this time, and that is how to set boundaries and rules around screen time. I know, like, my son's knowledge and interest in video games has expanded in a huge way. Our personal family values are that we don't like violent games with lots of guns and all that stuff. And so, like, really learning these games, these platforms that they're on, and setting those limits. I will say that the beauty of this year, and something that I've really valued in learning, is that my kids are pretty good about following the rules when I set them. So, like, and if one doesn't do it, the other will tell on the other one. So, you know, if Jack's on a Roblox game that has guns and shooting, Ellie will tell on him, and he knows that he'll get in trouble. So, really, like, setting those boundaries with my kids with the screens has really been a more positive experience than I expected. And I'm glad I didn't just throw up my hands and give up and say, oh, I'm just going to have to let them do it because this is the world we live in now. Can you guys talk a little bit about that, setting limits, setting boundaries with kids with the games, and for parents, like, what resources are out there for us to learn about these things? Because for me, like, I go to my Facebook and I'm like, you know, hey, Jack wants to play this game. Moms and dads, like, give me your hive mind on this. But what are ways that parents can get more information about these platforms that kids are on?
That's a great point. So I think it is important to still stick to whatever values you have. And so if there's certain values related to certain types of games, and I think having those limits are really important. Having open conversations with your family, and we're having a family meeting. We're gonna discuss screen time, because obviously things have changed. We're in the home more now, so we maybe need to kind of look at what our original plan was, but let's do it together as a family. So involving our kids, anytime you involve the children, like no kid's going to sign up like, yeah, I want to sign up for the plan where I don't get to play video games. But if you have a conversation and involve them in the plan, they're much more likely to go along with it. Using screen time as a reinforcer. So, you know, looking for opportunities to, reinforce the behaviors that you want to see more of. So using it as a reward, as a positive reinforcement for the things that you want to see more of, often can really help. But setting the limit, sticking to it. So having a conversation with yourself, or if there's another adult that's involved in taking care of that child, okay, what's the framework that we want to sort of set up here? And then having that family meeting and kind of setting it up with your kids. Resources, I think there are websites out there. Common Sense Media does a really nice job with TV shows and movies and video games. So they do a really nice job of looking at different things. And there's probably some other resources out there as well to try to, because the kids know a lot more than we do when it comes to electronics and games and things like that. So we have to try to arm ourselves with as much knowledge as we can, which is often kind of challenging.
And sticking with the Zoom theme, a specific question here is, if you are seeing your kid no longer motivated through virtual learning, are there resources to help out with that if you're not comfortable with them returning to school right now?
So I'll jump in there, I guess. You know, virtual learning has been a godsend, but then also very difficult. So it has done wonders for some kids who had anxiety about going to school, right? They've been able to connect. They've been able to be present in class without facing some of the things that they struggled with the year before. But after being on it for such a really long time, if you're not one of those kids who are, prone to cyber school kinds of activities, it gets old. It really gets old. I will also remind you that it's March, and even pre-pandemic, March gets old in education. Like, it's spring fever, the times have changed, everybody's getting a little antsy. I know in the mental health world, beginning of March through June is a really difficult time for people. So despite the fact that it's virtual or in person, this is a tough time of year. We're all just about done. We're definitely all just about done with a pandemic. But now we have to try to figure out how to get these kids to push through the remainder of the school year. A lot of it, I just think, is reality check, right? Like, you guys are almost there. We almost got this done. Let's make sure. Let's check in and make sure you're getting accomplished what you need. Let them take some screen time break, right? My colleagues might shoot me for that. But, the bottom line is every kid needs a little break. If they need to miss a class and make it up the next time. There's a lot of flexibility in this virtual world. Obviously, we want them to do their best. We want them to stay connected, but we can acknowledge that, yep, it's the last stretch. You're going to get through this. We're going to support you. What kind of support do you need from your teacher? Maybe they need additional support, but it's about talking to them about how we're going to get through this. What are we missing?
Yeah, I agree with Sue. I mean, I think that even pre-pandemic, by the time March rolls around, kids are done with school, families are done with trying to motivate their kids for school. So it's generally a tough time. Obviously, it's amplified now because of the pandemic. I think having discussions with the school is really important. So reaching out to the teacher, my kid is struggling on the virtual platform, what can we do? There are accommodations that can be made that can help kids that are struggling, whether it's due to focus and attention or anxiety, involving the teachers, the guidance counselors, with the problems can really potentially come up with some solutions. But the other things that I've often talked with parents about is kind of chunking it out, or like breaking it out into little time frames and saying like, okay, we have 10 more school days until spring break. Let's figure out how we can just get through the, because if kids think about like, oh my God, I have school for the next 3 months, it's overwhelming. And so if you can just get them until spring break, mm-hmm. and then you can get then you have 2 days off because of a teacher in service. So let's just get until that little break. And then let's get to Memorial Day. And so if you can break it down into smaller little chunks, oftentimes you can be a little bit more successful in that motivation phase.
We're almost there. And I think the other struggle too is that it's right around the time where schools are now coming back in person, right? So now you have kids coming back in person and kids staying virtual. And it's going to look a little different for them because there's going to be probably more kids in their classroom. And it's just going to be a little different for them. So if they're not going back in person, they're going to need an extra boost.
Yeah, I'm a huge proponent of family school partnerships under any circumstances, pre-pandemic, now. I mean, we know that when parents and teachers are working together collaboratively to support youth education, kids do better in all sorts of ways. And so I think the family school partnership piece of what Dr. Lewis was just suggesting is critically important. I think that, we also heard some talk about positive reinforcement for just meeting goals broadly. We can apply that to school, right? So 10 days till spring break, how about like 10 minutes till lunch, and then you can get access to whatever. Like sometimes the chunking actually needs to happen within the format of an individual school day, with opportunities for small rewards, breaks, and celebration of success. We all need to be doing that for ourselves too, by the way. So I think we again need to be modeling what we're trying to model for our kids right now.
Especially with the younger, like the third, fourth, fifth graders, their ability to like delay gratification is not the same as it is for teenagers or adults. So like maybe they might not be able to wait until this weekend to earn that reward. So they may need that reward, this afternoon or today, after they do whatever it is that you want them to do.
Rep Sappy, you follow.
I'm the question lady. I think this is probably for Sue, but you had mentioned early on, Sue, that the IU, the intermediate unit here in Chester County, has grown to 70 social workers that support our 12 school districts. Is that primarily for crisis intervention, or are those 70 social workers helping right now to support educators, to kind of looping in what you guys are talking about, to support the educators as kids are starting to come back into the building? And if not, is there conversation happening about how that's going to look, going into the fall and into next year?
Sure, absolutely. And I should clarify, we support all of Chester County school districts in our programming. Our mental health folk, we have in, I think, 7 districts at this point. So they use them a little differently in each of those districts, just depending on what their needs are. So some of those, in some of the districts, they support students who are newly identified needing assistance. Oh, I thought I was frozen. Sorry. And other times they support students who are possibly in the special education program. They need additional mental health supports to be successful in school. But obviously the goal always is to support the students in being successful in school and helping to meet the mental health needs that are interfering with their success. But yes, absolutely. We have been working within schools and consulting and assisting since last May to talk about how do we make this work for kids and what to be aware of, and trying to determine what students are at risk and how to deal with students who we have identified at risk, the whole gamut. So yes, and for the districts that we're not involved in, they're doing it too, just with different people, right? So teachers want to be armed with information on how to help kids be successful and how to identify kids who have higher needs and what to do with them when that happens. I didn't mention, I actually also head our crisis response team for Chester County, and we respond to crises such as, you know, suicides or deaths, or we responded several times through for issues where there's been COVID loss. So we're available to be able to support the school districts in what they need. Did that answer your question?
It did. Thank you very much.
You're welcome.
The next question here is, a lot of parents are having to make the decision currently on whether to go in person or not. Could you speak to some of, in helping them make that decision, what they should look for, how they know what is right for their kid?
So I can speak and then I'll stop. I'll stop babbling at you. But our programs have been in person since June. And I was very worried when we brought them back in June, our treatment programs, because we needed to have kids. They needed to be in person. We were very nervous. Our students followed the rules. They followed the expectations. They social distanced. They participated. We followed the rules. We made sure people were sick. If they were sick, they didn't come in. We quarantined when we needed to. And it's all been very successful. So I can only speak to my experience in that, and that the kids that have come in, once they've gotten in, they've felt very comfortable. I will qualify that. They're smaller class sizes, right? They're not a big school. So somebody going into a big school may feel a little more less controlled. But I know.
Go ahead.
Sorry, no, you're good.
I was going to ask the doctors from CHOP to also maybe touch on transitions for some kids it's not as easy for all kids. So, I think it's really hard for parents to assess whether it's a good time to transition their child. And for some kids, going back might be a really positive thing for them because they really, really are struggling and need it. And for some kids, staying home might be a really positive thing because they need that consistency and that familiarity and that routine. And so I don't know if maybe you all might be able to touch on that a little bit from that perspective. I'm hearing a lot of that from friends and neighbors as we all navigate these decisions.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, I think I've had this conversation with a number of families who are trying to navigate this, and it's sort of a multi-factor situation, right? In some cases, families are concerned because there may be a family member with a health condition that may put them at broader risk. So there's a consideration around individual family risk level. In other cases, I have a number of families I work with where the kids were experiencing some pretty severe bullying, and that's gone now for them, for bullying that was happening in person in the school environment. And so for those kids, the thought of having to go back in school in person and to be in a situation where they're concerned about adults' ability to intervene and address the bullying is really a lot of stress, right? I don't want to go back there because my life has felt a lot better. I am learning here and I don't have to be with those kids that were causing me so much stress. And so if those are the variables and the families in the situation where they think being back in person and having opportunity for social development and in-person interaction with teachers, which is so, really important for social development in this age range. Again, the family school partnership piece of the discussion is really an important part of the decision making, right? Like what are the things that you or your kids are worried about? Which of those things are sort of changeable? Right? Like if it's worrying about being with a particular kid or group of kids in the classroom because they don't want to go back to a bullying situation, how can we impact that and address it and then try and help the kids have a better social situation? If it's something that we can't really change, but we have to learn coping mechanisms around like fear related to virus exposure, right? Like, how do we all learn how to cope with that fear as we all start to kind of re-enter in-person life? And so I think some of those kind of coping strategies and working with your kids around how to identify what's a real risk and what's a perceived one that may not be as real, right? And so all of those kind of things have to be considered as part of the conversation. It's complicated.
Yeah, I mean, I agree with both answers, and there's so many factors that are at play. And, you know, it's a very individual decision for every family in terms of, you know, risk. Certainly, you know, the medical piece is so important here. But in terms of, you know, I wanted to touch a little bit on, you know, we've talked a lot about anxiety and how, you know, for some kids, this has helped. But we also have to be aware of, is that sort of reinforcing the anxiety, and more importantly, reinforcing the avoidance of the anxiety? And, you know, cyber school and online school, like, originally it was developed for kids who were like high achieving athletes or musicians, and because of these other things that they were doing, they weren't able to attend traditional brick and mortar school. So we have to figure out a way to get them to school. But then it's become over the years a place where just any kid struggling with school, I'm going to do cyber school. And so, yes, you know, virtual schooling is a really beneficial thing for some kids. But we need to make sure that it's in this particular situation, it's the beneficial thing for this particular kid, because it may not be. And, you know, for certain kids, getting them back into the school setting where they have the support of the teachers and the guidance counselors, and they have the peer interaction, is really important. Obviously, we need to make sure that it's done safely, but we need to make sure that we're not sort of continuing to have kids be in the virtual school environment when it's sort of detrimental to them in some particular way.
Thank you for that. And I do want to be mindful of everybody's time, so this will actually be the last question. And that is, what positive takeaways have you seen from this experience for this age group? Chrissy, it looks like you want to take this first.
Oh, no, I just think it's funny that everyone's like, huh, it's just waiting, wants to go first. I guess I can speak from a parent standpoint, I guess you could say, that, you know, for, you know, I have, my son is in second grade, so he's just shy of the age group that we're speaking about. But, you know, I mean, we've never had more time outside. We've never become bigger consumers of things they sell at REI and all the gear and things, right? Just hiking and biking and doing things. And I think maybe from a parent piece, it's just, you know, even though it's been challenging, through as just a positive thing to end on, you know, growth comes from challenging situations, and you really do see how resilient you can be as a parent and how resilient your kids can be and adaptable you can be, right? Because even think about where we were a year ago, like, everyone has to wear masks where you go, and now here we are, and, you know, it's just such a norm, it's so accepted, right? So maybe a silver lining is just more time together. We're all together all the time. But, you know, just more time outside, and also kind of when everything's taken away, everything's canceled, your calendar's completely clear, it does make you realize, okay, now once things do, we will get there, we're so close to opening up again, how can I be intentional about my time and what I spend my time doing and what I end up doing as our family spends time together, you know, and adapting and shifting back into what do I want to take away from this and keep, and what are maybe some things that I haven't really thought about for a year that maybe we could leave behind. So I don't know if that's helpful or not, but.
Yeah, I agree, Chrissy, with the family time, particularly we talk about the middle school kids, you know, sixth, seventh grade, you know, developmentally, they're starting to move away from their nuclear family and start to gravitate towards their, you know, the peer group around them. So this was an opportunity to kind of sort of keep them engaged and involved with the family. And so I think that there was lots of opportunities for families to reconnect in ways that they hadn't been able to do so before. And then you mentioned the word resiliency. I mean, I think we always knew, or I don't know if we always knew, but kids are far more resilient than we give them credit for. But this was like the ultimate test of that. And they passed with flying, they are passing with flying colors. We all are. And they're just showing how resilient they are. And we as parents need to kind of see that so that we can remember that. Kids themselves need to see that, like, hey, I got through this. So next time when I have this major stressor, I can get through it because I got through a year of virtual schooling and all these other sort of major things. So I think it's a real, you know, huge boost to like self-esteem and self-confidence.
All right, well, that concludes our question portion. So Rep Otten, I'll let you take it back to wrap things up.
Thank you, Tyler. Thank you, everyone. This has been such a great discussion. I know that Chris probably shares in this. We could spend all of our time talking about this one subject. It's just such a important subject to dive into, and also just such great information from all of you. And just to add on to the positives, you know, I think about this generation of kids and all of the things that they're going to be capable of because of this time. I think about my own life and the things that have changed me and made me grow the most, and they're the hardest things I've done, the hardest experiences, some of them things I didn't want, but were you know, put upon me. And all of the things that have made me as a human grow and become better are those hardest things I've had to do. So I just think that our kids are gonna, it's not just that bounce back between like last year and this year, but it's like the life experience that they have at such a young age, whether they were 5 when this happened or whether they're 15. I just think that this next generation is really gonna have some incredible tools to tackle the challenges that they face because of this. And so, you know, while it's been a really challenging year, it's been really, really hard, and nobody wants to do it again. It's just been, I really think that it is strengthening our next generation and making them problem solvers, people who are innovative and think about being flexible and not being afraid and tackling big problems. So so that's my add on to the positives. And I just want to say thank you again to all of you for being here and for the work that you do to improve the lives of our families and our kids. And I'll turn it to Chris to say our final goodbyes.
I can't top that, Danielle. That was awesome. I couldn't agree more. I really couldn't. And thank you all so much for the work that you do. It's as policymakers, we really rely on your expertise and your input, you know, and obviously our constituents, it's an honor to be able to give them access to your expertise as well. You know, I agree, Danielle. I think this next generation is going to be phenomenal and in their flexibility. And I look at that from my own experience. I, you know, sort of fall in between generations, and we really didn't have to give up too much or sacrifice too much in our lives. You know, we missed the Vietnam War, and, you know, we had 9/11, and that was a truly horrible thing that happened to our country. But this is something that I think Danielle hit the nail on the head here. We'll go, you know, follow them throughout their life and for the better of our country. So thank you all again.